Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome. My name is Terry Caulfield, and I'll be presenting today's webinar focused on Umler company administrators getting started. The objectives for today's webinar are to ensure new Umler company administrators will be able to manage and approve Umler permission requests, navigate the security management module, grant equipment rights, inspection rights, as well as approval rights when appropriate. We will cover how to add and accept confidential data rights. We'll review the enhanced process for transferring ownership and security management, manage Umler tickler notifications, and view usage statistics for your company. The Umler system is the industry database for tracking the physical characteristics, transportation, and equipment management for over 2 million pieces of rail equipment. Umler offers many benefits to the rail industry and equipment owners: access, data quality, real-time updating, and security. Today, we will focus on Umler security. Umler has two layers of security: single sign-on Umler permissions and the Umler security management module. SSO permissions will control which menu options the user can access. The security management module within Umler allows owners or agents greater control over access to their equipment, and users who have been assigned Umler company admin access will inherit the authority to accept or reject permission requests and grant users access rights for a given company. When users request access to the Umler system, they will choose from a number of permissions that are available. We will review the common user roles needed and how to approve the requests and grant access rights to those users who will need to perform equipment maintenance in Umler. Umler users include railroad companies, equipment owners, agents, shippers, repair shops, and other various entities. So there are many different users who need to access Umler, but not all users need every permission. When getting started, most Umler company admins will likely have assigned themselves the roles shown here in the first example. Users who only need the ability to perform queries should have their permissions limited to just the query roles. The maintenance users performing equipment updates or reporting inspections will need the Umler access for maintenance, the query roles, and depending on the amount of maintenance activity, they may request the Umler bulk upload access. For users that need to register or query components in the component registry application, they will need component maintenance access, Umler access for maintenance, and Umler query access. It's common for some users to select all the available roles, but as the admin, you should evaluate which permissions are necessary for that user and reject any that are not applicable. When a new company joins Umler, Railinc initially qualifies and grants the Umler company admin access only if no previous users have registered with that company. Once Umler company admin access has been assigned, the admin is delegated to manage all activities on behalf of the company. They can delegate an alternate company admin as needed, and they can assign themselves any additional Umler permissions and user access rights needed to perform update transactions. They are also responsible for accepting and rejecting permission requests for users under their company. Any unanswered requests will be rejected by Railinc after 30 days. When approving Umler access for maintenance permissions, admins must then log into Umler, go to account administration, and then under security management, choose administer access rights internal to my company, grant the equipment and inspection rights. We will review this process later in the presentation. If an agent is interested in becoming the Umler company admin, in addition to the letter of authorization, Railinc will require a letter on the grantor's company letterhead authorizing the specific users to have the company admin role. So now we will walk through the steps for approving Umler access for maintenance permissions. When you first sign into your account, you will arrive on the launchpad. Here's where you will see the list of your applications on the left side of the page, your personalized landing page in the center, and your profile on the right. To receive notifications when new permission requests are submitted for your company, go to Edit My Profile. Once inside your profile, scroll to the bottom of the page. You will see a message that reads, "I would like to receive access request emails from registered single sign-on users for companies or applications that I administer." Simply move the slider button to the right to agree to receive these notifications. When done, click Save Profile. We do recommend all admins sign up to receive these email notifications to maintain their company's permission requests. Here's an example email that an admin will receive. These notifications are sent for all company marks when users have company admin access for any Railinc application. Returning to the launchpad, there's also the tools section that is available for admins to use. They include a query tool to identify all users that have permissions under your company. Another query to find company admins for other applications, and they can review the single sign-on and launchpad administrator guides. Now let's review how to manage the permission requests that are submitted by users. From the launchpad, select Manage Permission Requests. All the pending permission requests will be displayed. And if you are managing multiple company marks and other applications, you can narrow your search by entering Umler, the mark or user ID, in the filter area at the top of the page. You will check the box to select the user and then select whether to approve or reject the request. In this example, I selected the checkbox to the left of the request and I will click Approve. If you need to reject one or more requests, select the permissions, enter a comment, and then click Reject. Comments are included in the notification email that the user will receive. For approvals, admins have the option to add an end date for permissions. And the effective date is the day the request is approved. Now we are ready to log into Umler. To do so, choose Umler from the launchpad. If you are an admin who is responsible for managing multiple company marks, after approving the Umler access for maintenance, you select the appropriate company mark from the drop-down menu. In this example, AARX is the company mark that I'm signing in under. Click Select after choosing the mark from the list. We'll arrive on the Umler homepage. From there, go to Account Administration on the main menu. Then select Security Management to grant the access rights. The Umler Security Management module supports an administrator's ability to manage access rights for intra-company users and manage access rights given to other companies, which is the inter-company access. In this example, I would use the administer access rights internal to my company, the company matching the permission request for AARX. And I will select Manage Intra-Company User Access Rights. Each maintenance user must be granted access rights to perform any updates in Umler. Next, I will select the user ID from the User's Access Rights page that identifies all the Umler maintenance users for that company mark. The user ID is not displayed. That would indicate the Umler access for maintenance permission has not been approved. Otherwise, the user ID will appear in this list. Be aware that from this screen, you cannot tell what specific rights each user has been assigned. You must separately select each user ID to see what rights they have been granted. Later in the presentation, I will demonstrate how to perform a search for all the users' access rights under your company. When you land on this page and see that it is blank, this means that the user has no access rights to perform any update transactions. Here's where you may add the equipment, inspection, and pull rights. Please note that pull access is for railroads only. In this example, we will click Add Equipment Right for this AARX maintenance user. After you select Add Equipment Rights, enter the required fields that are listed in red, description, and the effective date. You may enter an expiration date or leave it as the default. For any equipment-related access rights, admins can specify the range of equipment, but this user will have access to all equipment and you will select the specific type of access the user needs. The equipment type of access is important for the user to be able to perform certain update transactions such as add, modify, and delete. For railroad companies, they would choose the add, modify, delete equipment, and additional access is available such as the non-owner lessee removal and the access to add or remove cars from a pool assignment. But for this user, they will receive the standard add, modify, and delete equipment access. When finished, click Save. The next page displays a confirmation message that equipment rights were added successfully. This user also needs access to report inspections. So here you would select Add Inspection Right. As with equipment rights, when granting inspection rights, admins can always specify a time frame, the marks, and the range of equipment for which the user can report inspections. After entering the required fields, click Save. Confirmation message is displayed, and the user can now perform updates on AARX owned equipment based on having equipment and inspection rights for that mark. Click Done to return to the Security Management module. And if you need to make changes to your user's access rights, you would select the user ID. In this example, the same user has access to multiple marks, But under rail, they need pool rights to assign a piece of equipment to a pool. Since I'm the admin for rail, I can grant these rights to the user by changing the user mark selection to rail. From there, I go to account administration and then security management. I would then select manage intra-company user access rights. I would locate the user ID that needs the rights, click the radio button to the left of the user ID, and click select. The update the user's access page is displayed, and I would click add pull right. I would then add a brief description and the effective date. And I can enter an expiration date or leave the default. I can also leave the default of all pools in the range of pool section, or I can enter a specific pool ID or IDs. I will then select the type of access the user needs. That could be the ability to add, update, or delete a pool header, or assign or unassign equipment to a pool. When finished, I would click save. This user now has the appropriate access to perform all pool transactions for the rail mark. Next, on the user's access page is the ability to clone rights from another user. This function allows admins to copy all of a user's access rights to another user whose rights you are currently creating or modifying. Clone rights are added to any existing rights for a user, and you have the ability to edit those rights to customize them for the current user. This feature is limited to cloning of all access rights associated with a user. The single sign-on permissions will not be included as part of the cloning. So after selecting clone rights from another user, select the user ID and then click clone rights. Next, you click confirm clone rights and the access rights are now cloned to the desired user. This will be extremely helpful and will save you time if you're often adding users and you prefer to clone rights from another user. Another option on the update user's access page is the ability to delete rights from a user. When a user retires, is terminated, or no longer requires access to your company, their access rights should be deleted. Select the specific right and then select delete. You'll get a message to confirm the deletion. Click delete again and the rights will be removed. Click done when finished. In cases where a user may be receiving access for a temporary assignment, the company admin has entered an expiration date. After reaching that date, the access will no longer be available for that permission. So that is one way to manage how long an individual has access to perform specific maintenance transactions for various fleets. Occasionally, users may contact their admin for help with their Umler permissions, like adding or removing permissions from their user ID. To make these updates, the admin would go to the launchpad and select Manage User Permissions. Here you may search by the user's name or user ID. From the Actions drop-down menu on the right, select Manage User Permissions to add additional Umler permissions to their user's profile. You can select the permission you wish to add, enter the mark, and then select Submit. You can also enter multiple marks for the same user. Just be sure to use the Apply to All slider button, which auto-populates the selected marks for the multiple permissions. And then if you need to remove Umler permissions, also go to Manage User Permissions to search for the user, select the permission you want to delete, then click Remove Selected Permissions. Page refreshes and displays the user's current permissions. As with the access rights within Umler, any employee who is retired or no longer needs access to your equipment data, be sure to remove their Umler permissions. Next, as Umler administrators, you also have the ability to configure Umler ticklers. Ticklers are email notifications to alert users when a specific event occurs in Umler for equipment that you own or have permissions to. Ticklers allow account administrators to specify which types of event notifications should be sent by Umler and to whom. Some maintenance users or equipment owners may want to receive certain email alerts in addition to the company admin, so authorized users can take the appropriate actions. As a reminder, only company admins can enroll email addresses to the tickler subscription, so a periodic review of the email subscribers will ensure your tickler list is up to date. To access the tickler page, select Configure Ticklers from the Account Administration drop-down menu. Some of the top ticklers are listed here. One of the most common ones is the Conflict Status Notification. This tickler was recently enhanced and it now displays multiple conflicts in a single email and provides a clearer description of each conflict. The email includes the equipment ID, status code, element ID, and name, along with the element values, response codes, and error messages. Another popular one is Tickler 430. which can alert the owner or agent when another company restencils equipment owned by that company. So be sure to subscribe to the ticklers to help you as an admin better manage the equipment and your intercompany access rights. And also within the account administration tab is the usage statistics feature. This is where company admins can choose to monitor usage for any web service transactions or CSV downloads that are performed by users within their company. You would make the required selections for what you wish to view and select submit. You can view the usage statistics for all users within a 90-day period or view an individual user's statistics for a given month. These tools will be useful for managing usage activity with regard to equipment access and downloaded queries. So at this time, I'll have to check if anyone has submitted any questions. We did get a question. If the company admin is no longer at the company, how can I gain access as company admin? So anyone can request the role of Umler company admin. If the existing admin is not responding, having a backup is helpful. So the decision to have multiple company admins is up to each company. So thank you for those questions. As I mentioned previously, a common task for Umler admins is to administer access rights involving other companies. In this industry, rail cars are constantly being bought, sold, or leased to different entities, which requires the registration update in Umler to preserve ownership and control identity. So when your equipment transfers ownership, you'll need to go to account administration, then select security management. In the section that reads administer access rights involving other companies, select manage intercompany access rights profiles granted by my company. Here's where you will grant the view confidential data rights to the new owner for visibility to the equipment's build date, rebuild date, original purchase price, and any additions and betterments. The selling entity has never granted rights to any company before. Select the add a company option and scroll through the list to locate the company mark you wish to grant access rights. In this example, AARX has previously granted access to Rail, so you would select the mark and then select grant access right. Then select add view confidential data rights. The confidential data rights access page is displayed and you will enter the required fields. Description, the effective date, and you may modify the expiration date or leave it as the default. When you deselect all equipment, you can restrict the access by equipment initials, equipment groups, or equipment IDs. However, you can only select one of the options as shown in this slide. We've seen where admins have selected more than one option, but this gives more access than what may have been intended. We recommend admins who have previously granted rights under the Rights Granted by My Company section to review existing permissions that are active to make sure only one option is selected. If you see that more than one is selected, revoke and reissue as needed. Also note that there is a count function available that will allow you to count the number of equipment IDs. There is a large list in the equipment ID column. In this example, the three equipment IDs shown are the only ones that were granted confidential data rights. When finished, click Save to complete the transaction. Then click Done to return to the Security Management module. You will receive a note of confirmation message that the rights were added successfully and that the status will show as pending. From here, you can also grant additional access rights if needed, but to exit the screen, simply click Done. Here in this slide, the buying entity will accept the rights that were granted. If they have signed up for the appropriate tickler 200, they will receive an email alerting them that access has been granted to their company. To view the access, they will go to Account Administration and then Security Management. Next, they will go to Administer Access Rights Involving Other Companies, and select Manage Intercompany Access Rights Granted to My Company. They would scroll to the bottom of the page to find the pending permission. They would then select the radio button next to the access and then click View. The enhanced process for transferring ownership replaces the original AAR Form 88C. The screen displays a summary of the view confidential data rights that were granted. The company admin can click the Download CSV link to review the equipment details. The date is acceptable. The admin must indicate if the equipment was leased or sold. Then they would check the box to accept. An example of the CSV file is shown in the second image. Please note that by checking the box and accepting the confidential rights, the user confirms that the equipment meets all AAR requirements, that the cars have no structural weaknesses or damage that would cause an unsafe operation. And if the rights granted are for tank cars, The user confirms that they have received the copies of the certificate of construction and all other forms and drawings. Once the rights are accepted, a confirmation message is displayed, and the next step is to assign those rights to a user within your company. Click Assign to User, and a list of users will be displayed. Scroll to locate the user ID that is accepting the confidential data rights and or the user who will be performing the updates in Umler. Click Select, and after viewing the details of the access, click Save. The status of the access will show Accepted, and now the buying entity has accepted the confidential data for the specific equipment IDs and can perform the restencil to transfer ownership in Umler. The access has been accepted, but not yet assigned to a user. Restencil will not contain the confidential fields. So be sure to complete this step. As we wrap up our discussion on managing users' access rights and security management, I also want to point out that admins can go out and search for all users' access rights under their company by selecting the Search User Access Rights at the bottom of the security management page. They can enter any search parameter if they're looking for something specific, or simply select search and the results will be return all users, the type of access they have, who assigned it, and other details. In this example, I've selected all access rights and chose the status of active. Once the results were returned, I used the filter in the name section to locate all the access rights under my name. You can use the filter on all the columns listed to narrow down your search results. So I've covered a lot of information on what Umler admins will be responsible to do, and here are some reminders. They'll manage incoming Umler permission requests from the Launchpad. They will accept or reject from Umler permissions from their company for their company mark also via the Launchpad. For users with the Umler maintenance access role, they must log into Umler and go to account administration under security management and grant equipment and inspection access rights. When transferring equipment ownership, admins must grant confidential data rights to the buying entity, which ensures the visibility to the equipment's build date, rebuild date, and cost. Admins need to manage and assign ticklers to email addresses for Umler events and view usage statistics for CSV downloads and web service queries. As mentioned previously, they need to routinely check for users that are no longer working for their company and ensure their access rights are deleted and permissions removed. Third-party agents will be required to have a valid LOA to view and or to maintain Umler records for specified companies. The LOA policy requires annual revalidation. To recap permissions, if the user has the appropriate Umler access for maintenance, they can access the various maintenance options to submit update transactions. They first must be granted equipment rights and inspection rights access. Last week, we conducted an introduction to Umler webinar presentation that really covers the basics of Umler and how to perform many of the maintenance transactions listed here. Railinc recommends this webinar to all new Umler users. The webinar presentation may be found on the main Railinc site. Maintenance users who have the SSO role of Umler bulk upload can upload bulk transactions into Umler via CSV. Transactions like equipment adds, changes, deletes, or reporting inspections. When using this upload method, users receive a confirmation email when the records have completed processing in the database. Please note that you must be signed up for ticklers 400, 410, and 420 to receive the email confirmations for the completed transactions. To access, select Upload Download from the main Umler menu and choose Bulk Upload Transactions. Please be sure that your file is in a CSV format for uploading. And a link to the CSV file specifications is on the upload page to assist you with formatting your file. Once you choose your file, click Upload. The Upload Summary page is displayed, which has the summary information for the upload process. It will show the total number of transactions processed, the number of transactions successfully and partially applied to the system, and you will see the number of transactions that failed, if any. First image in the slide shows a successful upload, and the second image shows one that failed. For any failed transaction, the system displays the details of the failure. Users may click the Notice ID link to see more details as to why the upload failed. In this example, the upload failed because the data entered resulted in no changes being applied to the equipment. Click Done when finished to return to the Umler homepage. As I previously mentioned, there will be some users who may only need Umler access for query, which allows them to run various queries with the results displayed in the web browser, which is the default option. However, they have the SSO role of advanced user query, they have the option to output the results to a CSV file. After entering all the search criteria in the equipment query screen, it will scroll to the bottom of the page. There will be a drop-down menu to change the output from browser to a CSV. Click search and the browser will automatically download and save the file to the location of your choice. Note that company admins can also check the real-time usage statistics in Umler for all CSV downloads for the marks they manage. Also note that users that have component maintenance access will see component registry in the main menu bar. With this access, they can register railcar components, associate those components to a railcar, and run various queries. Users must have Umler access for maintenance to associate components to rail equipment. Just to point out, on the Umler homepage, if you click the contact list from the main menu bar, it opens Railinc's finest.rail application. Industry rules require all companies receiving access to Umler must register their company's contact information in the finest.rail directory. The reporting of your company's contact information to Finest Rail is a mandatory requirement prescribed under AAR Interchange Rule 114. It is important to keep your contact information up to date, both as a means to receive updates from Railinc and for the industry to contact your company. Next, on the Umler homepage, I want to mention the conflict management links you will see on the right side of the screen when you first log in. Next to each link is the number of cars that are in conflict. Each mark will have its own set of equipment conflicts. When you click the equipment units in conflict link, the equipment query page is displayed with a list of all the cars that are in conflict. From there, you may open a car record to review the specific conflict. Clicking the download equipment in conflict link gives users the ability to download their equipment and correct multiple conflicts at a time. After the second quarter release, Railinc created a new process that will send the equipment in conflict CSV file to any company that has equipment in conflict. The email will be sent to the company contact listed in Finest Rail under the Umler category. Please make sure your Finest Rail contact details are up to date to receive this report. There's also the equipment with component ID conflicts link that, when selected, displays all cars that have conflicts related to components. From the results page, you may open a car record to view this specific conflict. In this example, I'm looking at the conflict for rail 928. I click the link that reads, "Equipment is in conflict, click to view," which will take me straight to the conflict. The conflict message reads, "Component ID is associated to more than one location on the car." As seen in this slide, the same component ID appears in locations 1 and 2. So the car owner can nullify whichever location is incorrect. Please note that component conflicts do not restrict the cars from moving. Most car owners may have very few conflicts, but keep in mind that Umler is updated with new business rules, permissible values, and reference file changes every quarter, so it's possible that occasionally you may have some records that result in a conflict. Also on the Umler homepage, there are helpful resources available to all Umler users by selecting the various online tools. There are links to the Umler User Guide and Data Specification Manual, which are essential tools to help users understand the functions of Umler. Other helpful tools may appear as links, pop-ups, or surveys. We encourage you to use these tools to make your updates easier to complete. There's also the References tab on the main Umler menu that has more resources and training materials. When you click References, you will see a host of many other supporting documents, such as quick guides, templates, reference files, and video demos. This presentation will also be posted here for users to access at any time. Now let's discuss the additional options users have when making updates to Umler. They are the Umler and Component Tracking web services. Both services take place outside of the manual updating via the web user interface. Web services is a system-to-system communication that is sent via XML message. If you're interested in learning more about web services, please contact our customer success team at csc@railinc.com. Also available is Umler Special Reports. This is where you may request a more detailed and statistical analysis of your rail fleet. Please refer to the Railinc price list for all applicable fees. As information, most car owners are billed for the following Umler fleet services and products. As indicated, most fleet services are billed annually except for the Umler, Car Service Car Hire, and 10 Car Service applications, which are billed semi-annually. For more details, please refer to the Railinc price list located on Railinc's main site. Finally, it's important to remind owners or agents that equipment registered in Umler is subject to a per car registration fee, which is billed semi-annually. Also, Railinc administers the Umler AAR tech user fees and intermodal user fees on behalf of the AAR. Those fees are billed in January and July and the Umler semi-annual registration fees are billed in February and August. There's equipment under your company mark that has been sold, destroyed, no longer in use. They should be deleted from Umler prior to January and July 1st. If you need access assistance with deleting any equipment, please contact our CSC team. It is the responsibility of each owner or their agent to maintain the accuracy of their Umler registrations. As mentioned previously, with all releases, there could be new business rules, permissible values, reference file changes, so be sure to review your fleet. I'll pause one final time to check for questions. Did you get a few questions? First question we got is, are the CSV downloads free? So the answer to that is yes, there is no charge for CSV downloads. Another question we got is, who's responsible for deleting equipment that was sold? So the original car owner is responsible. So once a car is remarked, the buyer will notify the seller that they can then delete the old car from Umler. Another quick question was, can the equipment conflict list be sent to the Umler company admin? So if the Umler admin is listed in Finest Rail as the Umler contact for your company, then yes, it'll be emailed around the 15th of each month. And also, users can always view the list of equipment that's in conflict by going to the Umler homepage and selecting the download equipment in conflict link. I want to thank everyone for their time today. If you need any assistance with regards to Umler or any Railinc product, please contact our Railinc Customer Success Center. Thank you again and have a great afternoon.